Okay, automation versus human intuition. So, September 1983, Mr. Petrov, his job was to monitor the nuclear warning, early warning system of the Soviet Union when he noticed a missile incoming from the United States go across his screen. His job was to push that button if and launch an attack in retaliation. But he did not, because he stopped and thought for a minute, if we were really under attack, we would not have just one missile shooting at us. They would be coming from all over. So because he did not push that button and used his human intuition, he probably diverted a very large nuclear attack at that time when Russia, or the Soviet Union, USSR, and the United States were during the Cold War era. So today I kind of want to talk about how we reduce this noise to make sure that we can make sure that when we see that one anomaly that our analysts and our staff can take the time to really use a little bit of human intuition and make the right decision for the organization. So dwell time. We define dwell time, right, as how long has that threat actor been in our environment before we noticed that they were there. So the 2018 FireEye Mandiant report, the M-Trends report, this past year went up actually from 99 to 101. While the number went up a little bit, there was a very interesting surprise in there, is that more organizations were actually finding that threat in their organization before a three-letter agency came knocking on their door. So we're getting better at finding the stuff ourselves before somebody has to tell us that the danger is there, the threat actor is in our environment. So we asked for visibility, right? We said, give us some logs, give us logs, we need logs. We tell our user, we've taught our users over the years how to identify using their own human intuition, finding those phishing reports, sending them to the SOC. So now we've overwhelmed our SOC with all these logs. So now what do we do with all of this information? 2015 is when Gartner coined the term SOAR, which is our security operations and reporting stack. So really we wanna just focus on that automation and orchestration piece today when we talk about the SOAR aspect. Last August, SANS published this report about surveyed security operations team just to find out what kinds of things are you issues are you dealing with? How are you managing your staff? What's your pain points? Obviously, the top one was lack of resources. Right, we all know we have the skills gap and we're under resourced. But then 53% said that they had inadequate automation and orchestration. So how do we address that? And we know that we have solutions today. We have lots of vendors that are creating these things, but how do we actually leverage them and make use of them? And the bottom one was interesting to me. So lack of that orchestration, integrating tool sets and process books were commonly referenced as barriers. And then as we look down this stack of manual versus automated, we see that obviously the first one is they've only automated, most of the time what they've automated is the data extraction, but not actually automating those processes to alleviate the skills or the hours that it takes to process the alerts that they're seeing. Again, lack of skills, but lack of also automation is what they're finding is something that they're still struggling with. So as I started to do some research on this topic, I was looking for, is there a framework? We've been doing automation for a few years now, so has anybody defined what really should we be doing and considering in our frame and when we automate? So the first thing I found was testing automation, which really is about software testing, QA testing, not really having anything to do with security operations or incident response. And then I also found cloud security automation. Now that really is just about automation of setting up your cloud instances and mostly getting you to configure to the NIST 853. So really nothing still about security incident response. So what happens when we don't have a framework or some guidelines? Usually the regulators and auditors will come along and tell you how to do it, and are they the people that you want defining what that is? So just something that we need to start thinking about, like how do we ensure that we're doing the right thing so that somebody else who isn't a practitioner come along and tell us what we should be doing or trying to do. So just because you have a checklist and it's a process that you want to automate, is it something that you really should automate? Like I said, we still need those checkpoints where we need to have that human intuition reviewing some of your alerts. Some of your high fidelity ones, you still need somebody to look at and take some time to investigate what's really going on here. Okay, so email, phishing email, that's my sweet spot. So it's the example I use. It's what we see a lot of today in most organizations, because we've done a really good job of training our users how to detect a phishing email. But now we've flooded our security operations teams. They don't have time to even deal with looking at the box. They either ignore what's getting sent in because they're dealing with all the other alerts that are going on, or they're spending time looking at that and ignoring the other alerts. So just take looking at a simple process flow of, you know, email comes in, an analyst needs to look at it, and then, you know, and then follow their incident response team. And then after you've found our incident response process, looking at it, determining, is this malicious? And then taking the time to, okay, this is malicious. Now what do I need to do with it? I need to block the IP. I need to send the signatures down to my antivirus so that the endpoints can detect if somebody else gets it, clicks on it. Is there, you know, we get that malware somewhere else? And then maybe even send it off to our mail team to say, hey, can you quarantine these messages? Because this is bad. If something comes in, we don't want the user interacting with it. And then we want to send a response back to our user to tell them, hey, that was bad. Thanks for reporting it, because we should always be closing that loop. When I was doing security awareness, many times I would have users ask me, hey, like I sent that message in, but do they actually ever do anything with it? So closing that loop is very beneficial, especially right now we're seeing a lot of phishing emails come in that are subject line are invoice and purchase order. And when those are going to finance people, they need to know, like, okay, that was it good or bad? Because I actually need to do something with it if it is good and I need to interact with it. So then as we start to look at implementing some automation to these simple steps, right? Do you have the skill set already in your SOC? Do you have an analyst who maybe has a special interest in learning something new or writing a script? Or do you tap into your infrastructure, your IT sysadmin teams to say, hey, does anybody want to work on a special project? Get maybe a manager to loan them to you for a few hours so that you can give them a little bit of taste of what security is about, because we know that we have that skills gap, right? So how do we leverage some existing skill set and kind of repurpose them and get them interested in security? Because many times they want to know, hey, what's going on in there, and it gives them some insight in there. Because if we can use our operation, our analysts to kind of let them do some of these special projects and take their eyes off the glass that they're constantly staring at and work on the stuff that gets them excited and why they came into security, it kind of makes them happy analysts too. And then looking at your toolbox, what tools do you already have in your organization? We have lots of the vendor floors full. We have lots of disparate tools. Most of them all have APIs. How do you, so looking at what tool sets you have, is open source an option, right? To be able to leverage some, fill some of those gaps to knit those solutions together. So where do we start? So looking at what you've already seen in your environment is a really good place to look back and say, hey, okay, we see this type of alert happening so many times, when it hits a certain threshold, then we want to make sure we can automate that piece, because there's steps in there that we can just automate that noise away, and then be able to move forward. And when we see that in the future, and then just really understanding, like, are there some pieces of this that we can automate? And then as you start to automate, then what's your QA process to make sure that you're not missing something or that you're having those false alarms? And as you have false alarms, how can you tune those to better have better visibility to something that that you should be paying attention to? Oops. Change control. So as you start to create the processes that you want to automate, how do you lock down those scripts so that way you understand who's making changes to those? As you start to do this automation, and your auditors are going to want to know, hey, how do you know that you're going to miss something and that something that you're taking care of what you've written? Making sure that you have some criteria around how do you capture those changes and who's changing what. An organization I was at had set up a rule really nicely, and I'm going to actually go into this example in a little bit. Somebody kept turning it off, and then it got turned back on. So making sure you can manage that change control is really important. And then maintenance. How do you make sure that the things that you have in there are working? It's not just a once set it and forget it. You got to go back and make sure, is it really capturing the things that you have? I had talked to a team who had synthetic transactions that they would send through their process so that they knew that the process was working as it should, and they could also demonstrate that to their auditors, just so when this alert comes through, it does the thing it's supposed to do. And it actually helped them find an incident where a system went down, there was a failure in one of the systems that went out because that alert wasn't happening as it should happen. So I'm also keeping going back and doing a review to make sure, is it happening and is there more that we should be doing? Okay, so like I said, we'll go through another example of email. So user sends an email in. We had a large volume of diet spam that kept coming in. So our team wrote a quick little YAR rule that said, hey, if you see this diet spam message come in, go ahead and process it. There's nothing that we need to do with it. And then send a response back to the user. This was the incident where somebody kept turning that rule back on. As I would look through, I would go into the solution and look to say, okay, what are we seeing, so that I can, as an awareness person, look to see what's happening, what phishing emails are really coming in, so I can simulate that. I kept seeing this diet spam message come in, or messages getting tagged with this rule, but they weren't really diet spam. They were actually real phishing emails. So I would hand that back off to the leads, and they're like, okay, yeah, we'll take care of it. We'll turn that rule off. Somebody kept turning it back on. And we eventually just had to delete the rule because somebody kept turning it back on because there wasn't a good change control process around that. And like I said, when I was finding those real messages that were phishing emails, and then getting, because when we would tell the user it's okay to interact with it, they would get that response back, and then potentially they were now interacting with a phishing email. But then if you have enough, maybe you have more variables that you can add to your rules to make them more robust, so that way you reduce your chances of a false alarm. That can also enhance your automation process. So we have an internal, if a user is reporting an internal message because they think it's phishing but it's not really phishing, we can quickly just send them back a message saying, hey, that was good, you don't need to do it, like, don't worry about it. And then we had our HR department that would send out a warning message to the users, say, hey, we're going to be sending you this survey. It's okay to trust this message, Somehow they would not read that message, but they would report the survey message that would come in. And sure enough, we would get flooded in the sock with all these reports coming in that were legitimate messages that our HR team said, hey, it's okay to interact with this. I had finally found the person who was initiated the survey emails and got him to kind of give us a pre-warning so that we could make sure that the rules were set up, the automation was in place before those messages went out, because we would get bombarded with those messages in the SOC. Even though it was the same company that they were using, every time he did a new city, I made sure he was still telling me that, because I didn't want him to think that I didn't want to hear anymore, because there could be that one time that a new IP was added or a new sender that we wanted to add to the rule. So then as you start to build your automation, how do you determine what the ROI is on that? Are you able to save some resources? Are you able to make do with those gaps that you have in your resources? And then what about there's also the infrastructure impact of, you know, standing up the automation that you're gonna need to account for. And how do you justify that to your leadership? And then there's the time that you're gonna need to make sure that your CISO is, he knows that you're not over automating to miss an alert that might be necessary for them to take action on. So this was a year ago, and this was almost the same situation that we had in the beginning, where somebody did push the alert button and sent out this broadcast message and actually caused a lot of hysteria around. So sometimes human intuition can also result in a false alarm, but then there was also somebody there next to him to quickly divert that misfire of that alert. So as you start to think about your automation and where to get started, make sure that in the beginning that you're setting your objectives, understanding what it is you're trying to achieve. Take an inventory of your playbooks and find places where you can add that automation in there quickly. And do some small steps before you take on some of those bigger, high fidelity, high alert processes. And then in the long term, how do you show value for to get that? Taking what you've already done and getting support for further automation, and then creating those synthetic transactions for your validation. And that went way quicker than I thought it would, but I'll take any questions if anyone has any. Okay. Yeah. There's a mic right there for the recording.
When you talk about like orchestration and automation, is there any, well, I guess there are some tools that you can use, but would you kind of direct me into what type of tool that I should be looking for? Or if there are anything that I can do probably with scripting, Python and Perl or the,
so a lot of it is scripting, but I know there's some specific vendors I can talk to offline about some vendors that you could look at specifically for orchestration and automation. There's some platforms that are out there now. Okay. All right. Well, thank you, and thanks for coming.